another one. Good morning. It's lovely to hear this lovely buzz of chatter around the building this morning. It's lovely to know that you're all here, happy and ready to worship with us in this place. And we also greet those of you that are watching us and joining us online. You are very welcome. This morning, we are to be led in worship by Major Miriam Ward, who has been a member of this corps for some years now, and she's a very invaluable member. She does so much, and today she's going to lead us in worship, and we thank her for that. We do still need to greet her. She's one of ours, but we need to say thank you and welcome Miriam.
Thank you. I greet you all in the name of Jesus this morning. It's wonderful to be in his presence, whether you're online or whether you're here with us in the hall. We just love to be in the presence of God, don't we? To be able to worship him, praise him, and sit for a moment and listen to him, because I'm sure he has something to say to us through the songs and the worship that we follow today. We're going to start off with a call to worship, which will come on the screen. And I'd like you all to stand and join in the call to worship, which will be followed by the singing of the chorus, "I will enter his gates with thanksgiving," and stay standing for that. So would you all like to stand and join together in the call to worship this morning? Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. It is good to proclaim your unfailing love in the morning, your faithfulness in the evening. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. Was a good praise to the Lord, wasn't it? Would you like to be seated? This is really a day of celebration, so I hope you're ready to celebrate what God has given us. This is one of many days that we celebrate within the Christian church. Not that long ago, we enjoyed Christmas. Do you remember it? When God gave us his Son, Jesus Christ. A little bit nearer to today, we pondered on Good Friday, how the gift that God gave us, his Son, gave his life for ours. And then we rejoiced on Easter Sunday, knowing that Jesus lives. And then, just a few days ago, last Thursday, which was Ascension Day, we, with those disciples of long ago, stood perplexed at the fact that Jesus was leaving. He left. However, He didn't leave us without help. And that's what we're celebrating today. The giving of the power needed to go out into all the world with God's message of faith, hope, and love, just as Jesus exhorted his disciples to do. This was the glorious news. And so we're going to sing again. Glorious things of thee are spoken, Zion, city of our God. It's song 535, if you're using the songbook. And I invite you again to stand and sing these three verses through together. Solid joys and lasting treasure, none but Zion's children know. Glorious things of thee are spoken from one whose word cannot be broken. Jesus said, as he left on that ascension day, or just before that, I will ask the Father and he will give you another helper to be with you forever. So it's rightfully in order for us to ask today, come, Holy Spirit, and abide with me. Another older song. Maybe it's my age that's showing through, I don't know. Come, Holy Spirit, and abide with me. We're going to sing this chorus through together. Make it a prayer of yours today. And then Major David Borman is going to pray with us. Thank you, Lisa.
Let us pray together. Lord and Father, we worship you. We thank you, Lord, that we're in your house today. We realize, Lord, that we need you. Our hearts reach out to you. Oh, Lord, if ever we needed you, we need you now. Father, we recognize that you are Almighty God, Creator, Father. We recognize Jesus Christ as Emmanuel, God with us. And we recognize the Holy Spirit as the Comforter and the Teacher. Lord, we give thanks to you for all these great gifts that you've given us. Lord, we thank you for the time when you set our hearts and minds on fire. We thank you, Lord, that as the years have gone by, you have been there to guide us and to teach us. And your grace, your presence, your power has kept us. Lord, so many blessings, so many things, so many prayers answered, so many times when we've marveled that you have answered our prayers in such a wonderful way. Lord, we worship you, and we realize that we are poor sinners, that we, Lord, need you and love you. We love you so much, Lord. We want to say that. And yet, Lord, we recognize that you raised up the Salvation Army, that you raised up William Booth as a prophet by your great power, by your strength, and by your grace, we are still here. But Lord, we come before you because we need you now. Because Lord, the Salvation Army in this country is not in a good place. And we pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit will once again come and inspire us and fill us with your Spirit. Come again and fill us again with the Spirit of God. Set us on fire again. May we know, Lord, that you are with us always and that you are guiding us and filling us. Oh, Lord, come to us. We need you now. We pray for this meeting. We pray for your servant Miriam, Lord, that the word she speaks will be from you, that your word will not go out empty, but it will achieve that for which you purpose it. So, Lord, set your seal upon us. Touch every heart and mind here, young and old. We don't mind how young they are, Lord, because great things are done amongst young people. And seeds are sown. And we pray, Lord, for the young people of this court, that you'll bless them. And, Lord, that you will keep them, because this world is trying to tear them away from your side. And we pray, Lord Jesus, for us older people, that you will continue to keep us. We pray for those that have drifted away. Oh, Lord, we pray that you will trouble their spirits. We pray that the Holy Spirit will draw them with love back to you. And we ask this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ and in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Have you ever been asked if you dream in colour or black and white? Have you ever thought about it? We associate colours with different things. I wonder what colour you would associate with the Holy Spirit. The disciples thought they saw flames like flames of fire. Well, they would be red and orange and gold, wouldn't they? I think of the Holy Spirit more as blue or purple. Maybe because they're the colours that are associated with royalty. And who is more royal than God? We're going to sing a song together, number 250, which starts off saying, "Colours of day dawn into the mind." Now, I'm not sure that we have actually sung this song before. Has anybody sung this song? Now you see the words on the screen. One or two have. So that's good. So there are some singers. But I'm going to ask Mark if the band can play the tune through first to remind us of the tune, and then we'll sing the song through together. Thanks, Mark. Just the first going to ask Mark if we can have the chorus again, and while we're having the chorus again, your offering will be received. Thank you very much. Maybe we need it twice, Mark. I'm sure Nigel will be here in a moment to pray with us.
Thank you very much for your giving this morning. Just a verse from Psalm 48. We thank you, Holy Spirit, for gifts of many kinds, new life and love and power that changes hearts and minds. We praise you for the comfort and strength you bring each day as one who stands beside us and helps us as we pray. Let us pray. Father God, we come to you this morning. We thank you because you do give so much to us. We thank you that you meet our daily needs. And we pray, Lord, from what you have given us, that we give back to you what is rightfully yours. We pray, Lord, for this, the offerings that we have given today and through each day, each month. And we pray, Lord, that they will be used wisely for the help of the people within this community where there are so many needs. And Lord, we just pray that each person that receives will receive something from you and will want to know more about you. We ask this in and through your precious name. Amen.
Just a few announcements before we move further into the meeting. I want to say thank you to John Swansbury for continuing to publish the bulletin, even though he's moved away to distant shores. So I hope you've all received it online. If you haven't, then please do let me have your email address so that you can be kept in touch. But thank you to John for continuing that ministry. It is especially wonderful to welcome Major June Kitchen here today. Major June has been a member of this corps for many, many years, more years than I can remember, actually. But I don't think you've been here that whole time. But it's so wonderful that you've been able to join us today to celebrate what is your 70th anniversary of the session of the Shepherds. And I think also in training with you at that time was Mrs. Major Hennis, Nigel's mum, Lieutenant Colonel Stan Reed, lovely to remember him as well, and also Mel Townsend, if you're watching, your mother, I believe, was also a shepherd. So it's wonderful to commemorate the shepherds at this time, and it's lovely that June, you could be here to celebrate with us. Moving on into this week, the Home League on Wednesday, starting at 10, and the programme starting at 10:30. This week, talking about B's and T's. You'll have to come and find out whether we're going to be celebrating T's with the beehive or not, but I understand. I think it's National Bee Day during this week, so I think that's why we're celebrating the bees and the teas. Bees and teas. Next Sunday, our meeting will be led by Majors Susan and Ian Woodgate, and we look forward to their ministry. On Saturday, June the 8th, please don't forget that the musical Belonging is being performed at the Regent Hall at 7 p.m. Tickets for this event are available online, and you can press the link in the bulletin to take you to the relevant place for that. And of course, we have our own star in that, young Miss Laird. On June the 29th and 30th, please do keep that weekend free. We will be celebrating our corps anniversary. On the Saturday, starting at 3 p.m, we have a food tasting session from around the world. And this is courtesy of the various different nationalities represented in our church family here. So I think it'll be a good one to be here for. And that's going to be followed by a musical programme at approximately 6 o'clock after the washing up is done. But please do come and celebrate on June the 29th at 3 p.m. start. Back to today. Following this meeting, there will be refreshments available in the community hall. There will be a timbal practice in this hall after you've had your coffee. There is no open air this week. There is the youth rev meeting that was scheduled for tonight has also been cancelled. So no youth rev tonight either. For these lovely flowers, Merle and Louise, we thank you. We're remembering Henry, a great character of this corps. And as always, we've got the forget-me-not and the humbug, which he loved. Thank you to you both. Thank you for listening to me, and again, thank you to Miriam.
Now, who do you think is best to show us how to celebrate? The children. So let's have a party. Now, Belinda and some of your helpers are coming down to help us. Is this mic on? Yes. and the children have been colouring in pictures. Have you finished your pictures? Would you like to bring them out? Let's see your pictures. Oh, that's beautiful. Now we're going to put the pictures up along here so everyone can see them. Where's my helpers? They're on their way down. I think they've got some blue tack. That's very colourful. Yeah, great. Do you know what the pictures are representing? Anybody know? What are the pictures representing?
Pentecost.
Pentecost. It's a big word. Do you know what it means? No. Here we come with the blue tack. Or white tack. Blue tack we've got. So Pentecost is when Jesus sent us the power that we need to do the things he wants us to do. Is that a good idea? Right, let's have the pictures displayed. You can come and get them after Sunday school so you can take them home and show Mum and Dad and whoever wants to see them. Don't they look colourful? Now, while they're doing that and while we're having our party, I think we're going to sing a song, a chorus. Is that right, Lisa? Because we all like to celebrate. So we're going to sing, Come On and Celebrate. Oh, yes, Timbrels. Going to join in this party as well. So let's sing the chorus again as the band join in this party. This morning, but we have got what else?
Games,
yeah, balloons. We can have games, balloons. Anything else you have at parties? Can you say sweets?
Sweet.
There you go, sweets. Now I think we've got some of those for the children. We couldn't give the poppers to the children, we weren't allowed, but we can give the sweets to the children. And then the children are going to go out and have their time at Sunday school. Is that a good idea? Look at all those pictures. Aren't they wonderful? All representing Pentecost. Whoa, which one shall you choose? Choices are difficult. So thank you very much for your help today. If you put your timbrels away, your tambourines away in the box, and then go out to your Sunday school. And I think Alex is going to come now and share a Bible reading with us.
The Bible reading is those verses from Acts chapters 1 and 2. Acts chapter 1, verses 6 to 8. After the disciples met and ate meals together, Jesus told them that they were on no account to leave Jerusalem. When they were together for the last time, they asked, "Master, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel now? Is this the time?" He told them, "You don't get to know the time. Timing is the Father's business. What you get is the Holy Spirit." Chapter 2, verses 1 to 8 and 14 to 17. When the feast of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Without warning, there was a sound like a strong wind, gale force. No one could tell where it came from. It filled the whole building, then, like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks and started speaking in a number of different languages as the Spirit prompted them. There were many Jews staying in Jerusalem just then, devout pilgrims from all over the world. When they heard the sound, they came on the run. Then when they heard, one after another, their own mother tongues being spoken, they were blown away. They couldn't for the life of them figure out what was going on and kept saying, "Aren't these all Galileans? How come we're hearing them talk in our various mother tongues?" That's when Peter stood up and, backed by then other 11, spoke out with bold urgency, "Fellow Jews, all of you who are visiting Jerusalem, listen carefully and get this story straight. These people aren't drunk, as some of you suspect. They haven't had time to get drunk. It's only 9 o'clock in the morning. This is what the prophet Joel announced would happen. In the last days, God says, I'll pour out my spirit on every kind of people. Your sons will prophesy, also your daughters. Your young men will see visions, and old men dream dreams." This is the word of God.
Thank you very much, Alex. That was lovely that Alex could share with us this morning, and doesn't she read well? So that was the usual story, or the usual passage that is associated with this time of year. We read from Acts, and we understand something of what the writer is trying to share with us. But I'd like to read you another passage this morning. And this is from the book of Ezekiel. Now, Ezekiel was a prophet, and he was commissioned by the Spirit of the Lord. And he had various interesting things that happened to him. This is one I'm sure you will have heard of before. It might even prompt you to think of a spiritual song. I'm reading Ezekiel chapter 27, the first verse. The hand of the Lord was upon me, and he brought me out in the spirit of the Lord and set me down in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. And he led me around among them, and behold, there were very many on the surface of the valley. And behold, they were very dry. And he said to me, Son of man, can these bones live? And I answered, O Lord God, you know. Then he said to me, Prophesy over these bones and say to them, O dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. Thus says the Lord God to these bones, Behold, I will cause breath to enter you, and you shall live. And I will lay sinews upon you, and will cause flesh to come upon you, and cover you with skin, and put breath in you, and you shall live. And you shall know that I am the Lord your God. Amen. And I'm sure that reading has reminded you of the spiritual. Dem bones, dem bones, dem dry bones. Now hear the word of the Lord. But we're going to hear another word of the Lord sung by the songsters this morning. And the songsters are singing an older song, which was written by one of our former soldiers here, Brinley Boone. Thank you, songsters.
Thank you.
I think my nerves are talking for me this morning because we've missed out the band and we want the band message, don't we? So let's listen to the band before we share in a video. Thank you for that lovely message. Now, I found a interesting, well, I thought it was interesting, video, a short video, that speaks of the breath of the Holy Spirit and guides us how it travelled through the Old and into the New Testament. So we're going to share that now.
If you've ever heard the phrase, the Holy Spirit, and you want to know what it means, where do you start?
Well, you have to start on page one of the Bible, where the uncreated world is depicted as this dark, chaotic place. But then above the chaos, God's Spirit is there, hovering, ready to bring about life and order and beauty.
Okay, but what is God's Spirit?
Yeah, so the Spirit is the way the biblical authors talk about God's personal presence. The Hebrew word is ruach.
Ruach.
Yeah, you gotta clear your throat at the end.
So what is it?
Well, ruach can refer to a number of different things, but what they all have in common is energy.
Energy? How so?
So there's an invisible energy that makes the clouds move or the tree branches sway.
Right. Wind.
So in Hebrew, that's ruach.
Okay.
Now take a big breath. So you feel that inside you?
Yeah, the air?
Well, specifically the energy, right? The vitality in your body that you get from breathing deeply, that too is ruach. And this is the same word used in the Bible to describe God's personal presence. Just like wind and breath are invisible, God's Spirit is invisible. Wind is powerful, and so God's Spirit is powerful. And just as breath keeps us alive, so God's Spirit sustains all of life.
Yeah, ruach.
Now, as we continue on in the story of the Bible, we see God's Ruach giving special empowerment to people for specific tasks. The first person in the Bible this happens to is Joseph.
God's Spirit enables him to understand and interpret dreams.
And then it happens to this guy named Bezalel, and he's an artist.
God's Spirit empowers him with wisdom and skills. He's given creative genius to make beautiful things in the tabernacle.
And we also see God's Ruach empower a group of people called the prophets.
They're able to see what's happening in history from God's point of view.
That's exactly right. And here's the problem as the prophets saw it. While God's Ruach had created a really good world, humans have given in to evil. They've unleashed chaos into it through their injustice.
A new type of disorder.
Yes, and the prophet said the Spirit would come, just like in Genesis 1, but now to transform the human heart, to empower people to truly love God and others.
How will this new act of God's Spirit happen?
Well, centuries pass, and we are introduced to Jesus. And at the beginning of his mission, there's this beautiful scene where Jesus is being baptized in the waters of the Jordan River.
Yeah, the sky opens up, and God's Spirit comes and rests on him like a bird.
This story is saying that God's Spirit is empowering Jesus to begin the new creation. And we see this happening when he heals people or forgives their sins. He's creating life where there once was death.
Now, Israel's religious leaders oppose Jesus, and they eventually have him killed.
But even here, God's Spirit is at work. The earliest disciples of Jesus, who saw him alive from the dead, said it was God's energizing Spirit that raised Jesus.
This is the beginning of new creation.
Yes, and it's still going. When Jesus appeared to his closest followers, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit."
And soon after that, the Spirit powerfully comes on all of his disciples.
So that they can become a part of this new creation and share the good news and learn how to live by the energy and influence of God's Spirit.
And so today, the Spirit is still hovering in dark places.
Yes, pointing people to Jesus, transforming and empowering them so they can love God and others. And the Christian hope is that the Spirit is going to finish the job. The story of the Bible ends with a vision of a new humanity, living in a new world that's permeated with God's love and life-giving Spirit.
I felt that was a good explanation of how the Spirit came and what it meant as it traveled through the Old Testament into the New and on in. It's still traveling. Let me tell you about Trevor. Trevor was a fisheries inspector. He was a Salvationist, used to come regularly to the corps that I was soldiering at the time. But occasionally he had to miss a Sunday morning meeting because he was on duty. And this particular Sunday morning, it was a beautiful Sunday morning. The sky was blue, the sun was shining. It wasn't too hot, it wasn't too cold either. It was just right. And Trevor wandered down to the spot where he was to start his inspection that morning. He was on the mouth of a river which led out to the sea. And he sat among the tall grasses, thinking about us gathering at the meeting at the same time. And then he felt something flutter across his face. He brushed it away, thought it was a fly or something. But it wasn't a fly. There wasn't anything around. Nothing was moving. It was totally calm. He stood up to have a look and see what it was that was around him. But he couldn't see anything. But he felt a breeze flutter across him. He looked down at the grasses. Now, they weren't moving, but this breeze was blowing. And suddenly he felt it within him. And then it occurred to him that though he wasn't in the meeting, he was feeling the presence of the Holy Spirit blowing into his life and filling him. That evening, as we used to have evening meetings then, he couldn't wait to share his testimony and tell us what had happened to him that morning as he was sitting among the grass. And he kept saying, the grass didn't move. There wasn't any movement around. But I felt this wind blowing across me. Must have been a bit like the disciples on that first Pentecost. And as we saw, the Spirit of God was there right back at the beginning of the Old Testament. The Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. And that Hebrew word ruach is used. And that word is used through the Old Testament and is translated into many things: brood, flutter, move, shake, and of course, wind. And it's the same Hebrew word that is used in that passage in Ezekiel that I shared with you. When God said to Ezekiel, prophesy into these bones that the breath of life may come upon them. Ezekiel did, and the bones came to life. It must have been a fantastic vision. And it made me think of a time when I visited Alice Springs a long time ago in Australia. And we went for a flight in a helicopter, the one and only time I have been up in a helicopter. And we flew over this high mountainous area, and there was a dip in the mountain, and the pilot said, look down. So we looked down, and in this dip, which could look a bit like a valley, it was full of bones. White, dry bones. And as I looked down, I thought of Ezekiel and his valley of dry bones. I didn't want to get out the helicopter and try breathing into those bones, but it did make me think. And I love it, the way that God uses so many illustrations to bring us back to his word at different times when we're in different places. Most of you will know that I'm a nurse, and most of my working life has been in nursing. And I have often found myself in the situation where breath seems to have departed from a person that we're looking after. And quite often, it has meant that we have had to try to breathe. Now, when I was working in India and Africa, we didn't always have the machines that you have here, and we had to blow often into the person. It's hard work, I can tell you, to try to expand the lungs with the breath that you have. Sometimes it worked, and sometimes it didn't. But again, I would be reminded that it doesn't take a lot for the Holy Spirit to breathe into me, to breathe in and to fill me, because his breath is life-giving. There's a couple of verses in John's Gospel that always encourage me. This is the day after the resurrection. On the evening of that day, the first day of the week, the doors being locked where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples were glad when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, even so I am sending you. And when he had said this, he breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit. Now that was before Pentecost. Jesus breathed on the disciples and said, receive the Holy Spirit. I like to think that on the day of Pentecost, the room was crowded. Not just with the 12 disciples, but with other people the women who had accompanied them so often on their trips, probably cooked for them, probably even did their washing. But I like to think that that room was crowded and included some of these women and other followers. Just as Mary Magdalene had said to them, she'd gone to tell the disciples, she must have stayed there, that Jesus was alive. And of course, as we look into the passage that Alex read to us, it does indicate that there was quite a gathering taking place. They were all together in one place. And then the wind came, a strong gale force wind. No one could tell where it came from. And it doesn't tell us that the doors blew open or the windows blew out. No, there was a gale force wind, just like Trevor when he sat among the grasses. They could feel it. They could sense it. Like a wildfire, the Holy Spirit spread through their ranks. This was quite a shock. Nothing like this had ever happened to them before. It was a surprise, not only to them, but you can imagine that they would have started talking. Did you feel it? Did you sense something? What do you think it was? Something's happened. There was a wind, but the door was still shut. But the wind blew. And as they were talking and chattering, you know what talking and chatter does, it moves out of the room and other people hear it. And the crowds that were gathered in Jerusalem at that time of the year, because it was a festival, it was a harvest festival, which always occurred 50 days after the second day of Passover. And the crowds heard it all. They heard it. They heard the gossiping. They heard the surprise, the shock that was being expressed. And then Peter gets up and shares with them what has happened and explains to them that actually these people are not drunk, as you are accusing them of. But how do you tell a crowd of people steeped in their Jewish faith that this is something totally new that God is giving to his people? And it didn't stop there. There's an incident later on in Acts chapter 10 when Peter is asked to go and minister to a Roman centurion called Cornelius. Now, by this time, the disciples had felt that before the people could receive the Holy Spirit, they should be baptized. After all, John the Baptist came to show them how people should be baptized into repentance. And then Jesus came and showed his way. And now the Holy Spirit has come. So shouldn't this follow the natural sequence of events? But when Peter went and shared with the Roman centurion, in his house, with other Jews with him, and with the centurion's servants, Peter was speaking and sharing with them who Jesus was, how he'd come, what he'd done while he was here. And then the Acts chapter 10 tells us, while Peter was still saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word, and the believers from among the circumcised, that was the Jews who had come with Peter, were amazed, because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on Gentiles, even before they had been baptized. You see, we don't organize God. God organizes us. We don't organize God. We can't tell him how and when and where he should act. God organizes us. This gift is given freely to any who believe. I was reading in one of my daily readings this week Michael Mitten wrote, "This is not a gift awarded after months of study or granted to those who are particularly holy." And I love this next phrase. "It's a gift for beginners and is a gift for any who are humble enough to know they need help." Cornelius and his household were beginners. They were beginning to learn about the faith. It's a gift for beginners. They were humble enough to go to seek help. Cornelius didn't understand about Jesus, who he was, what his message was, what his life had been like. So he sought for help. It's a gift for beginners, and it's a gift for any who are humble enough to know they need help. And you know what? It's a gift that's here today for any who want to receive it. If you want it, it's yours. We used to have some musicals in the Salvation Army some years ago, and one of the musicals was called Glory, and it had that song with that phrase in it. If you want it, it's yours. The words go like this, and I think they can apply to our hearts today, to some of us. In your heart of hearts, are you a trifle weary? Is there part of you your better self deplores? Do you want the power to be a better person? If you want it, it's yours. Is your mind mixed up and are your thoughts in turmoil? Are you tired of fighting? Are you sick of wars? Would you like some peace instead of inner conflict? If you want it, it's yours. Are you somewhat sad and wish that you were happy? Real contentment has a special set of laws. Joy is not for sale. It's only found in Jesus. If you want it, it's yours. Do you want the power to be a better person? If you want it, it's yours. The Holy Spirit is freely given to all who believe. He will breathe upon us the breath of life, the breath of eternal life, that will guide us through this life and into the life after. And we're going to think about that and ask about it as we look at Song 294. And as Lisa plays the tune, I'm going to ask Graham just to put the verses on the screen one at a time. And then when we've read through them quietly and prayerfully, we will then sing together the first verse. So let's just read in our quietness, in our meditation, the words of Song 294. So we'll go back to verse 1 and sing that verse together. Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with life anew, that I may love what thou dost love and do what thou wouldst do. Sing together. Breathe on me, breath of God. Father God, as we have been reminded this morning of the day of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit was given, not just to the disciples, but to us all. When we have remembered that this was a free gift, freely given, and we realize that today we can come to you and say, breathe on me, breath of God. Fill me with life anew. Father God, we want to be better people. We want to be more willing to share your gospel, your love, and bring faith and hope into the lives of those around us and those we meet on a daily basis. But sometimes, Lord, we feel so weak and so helpless, and we can't do it on our own. And so this morning we pray, breathe on us. Give us that energy, that strength that we need to share with you, to share you with others. We are your children and you love us so much. And we pray that you will give us all of the things that we need until this earthly part of us glows with your fire divine, and people will hopefully see that glow and want to know more about you. So we give you our thanks for the gift of the Holy Spirit, which is freely given to each one of us. Amen. Now we'll turn to our final song, 326. And I really felt we couldn't have a Pentecost Sunday without singing this song, written by our founder, William Booth. 326 in the songbook, if you're following that. Thou Christ of burning, cleansing flame, send the fire. Again is a prayer, isn't it? So we're going to stand, and with the band's help, we'll sing these four verses through together. Thank you.
Thank you.
Ballad Jones and Russell Watson are going to sing. Oh, they're not. Apparently, it's not on. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Amen.
Face to shine upon you, to shine.